Dave Fanning on 2FM.
Indeed it is. Now, let me see. We wouldn't be known for kung fu movies in this country, but last week a kind of lost urban legend of a film, can I call it that? It finally came to light when somebody found it and brought it to a brand new audience. It was shot in Galway not that long ago, actually, around the year 2000. Moving Target is what it's called. The plot features an American visitor that gets caught up in a bizarre plot involving a six-pack of Beamish, the IRA, Russian nuclear bombs, random kung fu fights outside a pub and letter frack, etc. Now, before I chat to the man who unearthed this gem, here's a little bit to tell you about it, which would really, like, it's only 18 seconds worth of, gosh, once you hear this, you've got to watch the movie.
He wants his girlfriend back, but the ransom isn't payable in cash.
The beer contains nuclear detonators. I ask you again, where is the Beamish?
I drank it.
Now you have a chance to be a big hero.
Moving Target.
Where is the Beamish? I drank it. There you go. Colm. Colm, are you there, yeah?
Yeah, I'm on the line.
Good man yourself. And Billy, are you there?
I am indeed, yeah.
Good man yourself. Okay, Colm, I'm going to start with you. You're the man who trawled the internet to give us Moving Target, and Bill Murphy is the other one, one of the stars of the movie. We're talking Oscars coming up in a few weeks' time, so I'll talk to you about that. The lads are here now to tell me about one of the kind of weirdest Irish movies ever made. Now, I've got to be honest about one thing, right? I watched half it this morning, okay? And I don't want you to tell me too much about what might happen later because it's really exciting. And I'll tell you the part that I'm at. And I'm going to watch Manchester United and Liverpool and then I'm going to watch it at around 6 o'clock. I can't wait for the second part. It's fantastic. So, Colm, I'm going to start with you. This movie has nothing to do with you, really, has it? You kind of found it.
A bunch of these movies got made in Connemara by, like, the legendary B-movie producer Roger Corman. Like, way back, late 90s, early 2000s kind of thing. And some of the last movies were made there. And T.G. Cahir put out a documentary about it back in 2014.
Yeah, Brian Redman made the documentary, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. So my girlfriend found a copy of that documentary. We sat down and watched it together, like, in August. And, like, for all of 20 seconds, there was that clip of, like, the beer contains nuclear detonators. Just shots of, like, six packs of Beamish movie across the screen. And I was like, I need this. So, like, I looked online for it, and there is no trace of it. It's not on any streaming platforms. There wasn't any, like, pirate copies of it floating around. And a lot of these films, they kind of exist out of copyright now. Like, the studios are dead. I see actors linking to streams of the movies. But this one was just gone. So I did the right thing. I put up some eBay alerts. I found a guy in France who was selling it. I had no idea if it was in English or not when I bought it. I picked up a copy, ripped the DVD, and then I was like, now that I have it, I kind of have to turn to an event, right?
Yeah.
Like, the cult cinema has this whole thing of, like, audience participation, has this whole thing of, like, people just love to rewatch and tear a film apart. And I thought that if I could get this thing in front of a huge audience, if I could make it into a cult classic overnight, that would be perfect. So without really authorization or asking permission or anything, like, I kind of just took a chance on it. I didn't expect that I'd have to face up against Bill Murphy on the other side of the phone call, but it is what it is. But no, it's incredible. Like, I think it's such a bizarre piece of, like, this combination of all these weird Irish elements and then, like, the very American B-movie film tropes. It's not like anything else I've ever had the joy of seeing in my life, and I'm really happy to have, like,
well, in terms of cult classic, I'll tell you, you've got me halfway there, because I'm absolutely with you completely, I'd say, by about 7 o'clock this evening. So, Bill, just as a matter of interest, who are you in the movie? I kind of might have missed out there.
I play Mickey.
Which one is Mickey? I forgot.
Mickey is the guy who opens the first scene, the guy looking through the binoculars, and he kills this guy inside and a garage with a petrol.
Holy cow! Kills this guy inside in the garage. I thought this guy pulls into a garage, right? Which is that a real kind of garage with the real name on it? As you pull in,
it is. Yeah. It is,
okay,
yeah.
So you pull in there, and the guy gets out of his car, and your man puts the nozzle of the yoke into his face, and then puts all the petrol down inside him. Then he whacks him. The other guy whacks him with the boot of the car. Then he shoots your man. It's like, wow! Hold on a minute. Wait a minute. So you're the poor guy who gets shot with the guy with his head in the boot.
No, I'm the guy who shoots him.
Oh, you're the guy who shoots him. Sorry, right, yeah. I get you. Right, okay. I was hoping you were the other guy because he's terribly handsome as opposed to you. Okay.
I'm ugly, Dave. Is that what you're saying?
Okay, so then, like, what happens then? Like, did you get sort of a lot of offers after this movie?
there were offers, but there weren't movie offers.
Yeah, right. And, but, like, you know, how did you get involved in it?
Well, I had done another three movies up there with the Roger Corman Studios, and they had known that I had some martial arts experience, And I got a phone call from my agent, Ann Curtis, at the time. And she said, they were casting this. Do they want to go up for it? So I went up. And they weren't too interested in my acting abilities at the time. They were more interested in my martial arts abilities. So they had a guy called Yoram Astrakhan, who was the DP. And he wanted to see if I could actually do those moves, do those sequences in a certain way that the camera could pick them up. So we spent 20 minutes working on that. And then I got a call probably 24, 48 hours later to say that I had the role, you know.
Well, because like, there's plenty of martial arts in it. There's lots of fights in it. Who plays Ray, by the way? What's his name again, the main guy? Don the Dragon Wilson.
Don the Dragon Wilson. He was, he's an amazing guy. He's a lovely, lovely guy. And he was a 5-times world champion kickboxer.
Yeah.
And then what he did was, he kind of, like a lot of those martial artists do, same as Jean-Claude Van Damme, they kind of diversify into films and they become the main role then. But it's all about kicking, it's all about fighting. You don't kind of watch martial arts movies for the plot, you know.
I don't know.
But like the plot you get into.
Yeah, hold on a second. The plot in this is pretty good, actually. You know,
yeah.
And it's all about nuclear devices in a packet of Beamish, in a 6-pack of Beamish.
As you do,
yeah. And like your man, the poor old guy who sells the Beamish near the beginning to the American guy, your man comes out and says, "Where's me Beamish?"
So what I love about this film is that it's actually supposed to be a remake of another one of those Don the Dragon Wilson movies. They just moved another one of his films from Los Angeles to rural Ireland. And like, That's where all the stuff with the Beamish and all like the like weird Irish plot points that come from. And
well,
like,
that story, you
couldn't write this from scratch. Like, it's hilarious.
That story was initially, it was another script called Fatal Deviation. And actually at the time that film, Moving Target came out, the fans of Fatal Deviation were up in arms and they really gave soft to Don the Dragon Wilson because they felt that they were, you know, they had been deceived. They had been, you know, he was being disloyal to the fans of Fatal Deviation, you know.
What a fantastic... Can you imagine sitting around the table saying, what do we call our movie? Fatal Deviation. Brilliant. That's just... By the way, Moving Target. Yeah. When you were looking for Moving Target, wherever you happen to look, all online, etc.,
yeah.
Did you come across the Jason Bateman movie from the late 80s?
Oh, there's so many films called Moving Target.
Oh,
there's like
right.
10 of them, right? And like finding any information about this one, about why this was happening at all, like by the time I got a look at it, the only things I could find were someone put up an Italian translation of it at one point online. There was like a couple of reviews from it from like 10 years ago, and that was it. Like, no, as far as I know, it didn't even really come out in Ireland. Like, maybe it was at the Galway Film Flower or something like that, but like, obviously, we weren't the target audience for this. It's American people who don't know what a bottle of Beamish is. It was kind of aimed towards.
Right, yeah. You know, the funny thing is that, like, some of the bits in the movie that I really want me to make sure I see the rest of it is, like, things like when Alice is being held by the baddies in the house.
Yeah.
And... you know, there's banging on the door and they kind of have a gun on her saying, you know, tell your man to go away or whatever it is, you know. The music is straight from a really cheap hotel in the lounge, you know. It's just like, what is going on? But the best of all is Siobhan. Siobhan, and who are you? And he holds the gun on her and she says, you know, I'm Siobhan, I'm Alice's friend, kind of thing. And your man still has the gun on her. And there's a dead body or two in the corner and she doesn't give a hoot in Alice's house. It's fantastic.
Now, When I did the live stream, we had like 400, 500 people in a live chat just tearing the film apart as it was playing.
What?
And like,
tearing
people
it apart?
Into,
nonsense.
People
crazy.
Absolutely love Siobhan. Siobhan was a fan favourite. People were losing their minds that like Don the Dragon Wilson didn't just turn his affections instantly towards this woman.
Yeah, because I'll tell you, Alice was a bit slow, all right, not letting him give her a kiss and all this kind of thing. You know, she was, and of course, Alice, called with the red dress to give her for the night's meal. Anyway, let's get back to what this is all about, because we're talking about a movie that was, let's just say, lost and now found by Colm. And Colm, why did you decide to do the live stream? I mean, you decided the best thing to do was put it up on YouTube. What was the response like?
Well, like, as I said, we had maybe 4,000 people tune in on the first night. People have been watching it during the week since. People have, like, called in, watched it on Zoom chats with friends. We had a live chat going as well. 400, 500 people reacting to it in real time. Like, and all sorts of people. You recognize, like, names of the Irish music scene and so on if you look back at the chat log. Like, it created this whole culture around something that no one knew about a couple of days before. So it's all been really exciting. I've seen film posters made by like newfound fans of the thing and everything. It's like original art being made because of this ridiculous movie from 2000.
Really?
So, live stream, it really brought... I can show you...
What was the main feedback, Colin, on that?
Just people are just, like, getting a great kick out of it. Like, I mean, like, obviously there's weird bits of it that just don't hold up at all. But, like, I think people just get a huge kick out of seeing this very American B-movie style of thing happening and just being able to be like, oh, I know that pub. I used to go there. Or, yeah, that's Corinthian Rugby Club. All like, just... There's a familiarity and just bizarreness at the same time. When you put those two things together, it's just hilarious.
So listen, wait a second. Are you going to do another live stream?
I don't know, because I don't have many films like there, right? Like, I watched the documentary, and there's a lot of like interesting B-movie stuff that came out of Corman Studio. But like for the most part, like nothing kind of has the same bizarre, like humorous element to it that Moving Target does.
There's a couple of moments up there. There's a film called Space Jack, which is equally as bizarre as that one. And there's a film like there's a lot of big names went up to Corman back in the late '80s or the late '90s. Yeah. James Brolin,
yes,
who did a film up there called My Brother's War, and actually that he was doing that film so he could get his director's card, and he got his son Josh Brolin. And this was Josh's first big lead in any movie. And you know where Josh Brolin's career went, you know?
Yeah, and then you had Country for All Men and all that, yeah.
Yeah, and then you'd won the Carradine brothers came over and did another film called Suicide Club there, you know?
Are you still acting, Bill?
I'm still acting, yeah. I just finished shooting Vikings Valhalla. And I have a film coming up in April that I'll be shooting called Sacred Heart, written by Andre Coyne and directed by Frank Kelly. But back there in the '90s, there was. Do you remember James Marshall from Twin Peaks?
Not really. Who was James Marshall?
He was the kind of the romantic lead in Twin Peaks, the blonde guy, the biker guy. He did a movie up. I did a movie with him up there in '97 called Criminal Affairs, which is another, you know, crazy movie. But Roger Corman put so much money into that studio, and he gave so much work to an awful lot of crew members. Big start to people who are now working in the main film business, people who are working with TG4, people all over the world who actually got a start there in Roger Corman Studio, you know?
Do you know who one of the people in the movie is who plays a guard and has one line in the movie, something along the line of, this looks serious, or something like that? Do you?
I don't know.
Do you not? Okay, well, I'm going to tell you, because I rang Brian.
It wasn't you, Dave, was it?
No, I rang Brian about a half an hour ago to tell me anything about the movie that these guys might know. Hector! It's Hector!
No way! And look where he is now. You know what I mean?
Yeah, indeed, absolutely. World stardom. Yeah, Hector.
I missed that entirely.
Yeah, well, I don't think I've come to that pitch yet, so that's why I wouldn't have known. But anyway, not that I would anyway, probably. But anyway, it's Hector. I think he says something like, "This looks serious," or one line or something.
Yeah,
but that's for the next live stream. But like, you know, on the live stream, I presume everybody was like texting all over the place, and it was just really fun while you were all watching it at the same time.
Yeah, if you're watching it back on YouTube, you can actually click a button to see the chat log as it's happening live. Okay. So like, you can see like people really getting into it. And like, I mean, I don't think this is going to be my thing. I don't think I'm going to be like the film guy, because like, again, copyright and all of that is never going to always be as easy to get around like it was this time.
Yeah.
And I mean, I do other stuff online as well. I helped run a record label down in Cork. I have like some other social media bits going on. So like I'd love to do this again, but I feel like now I do have to watch Space Jack. Space Jack as a title just sounds...
Yeah, that sounds pretty good to me too. So the one we're looking at here is called Moving Target, and it's a kung fu action flick set in Galway. So you're fighting Bill near the beginning. Like, there's a major... You know when your man, Ray, is it the American guy? He's going to get into... the main guy, Don the Dragon Wilson. He's going to get into a taxi. And then there's a fight about the six-pack, and they have a mill outside. Like, that's pretty heavy stuff, isn't it? It's pretty together. It's well choreographed.
It is. Well, what Roger Corman built this big, huge manor house for him when he'd come over. But when he wasn't there, we got a chance to stay there. And what we would do every evening is we would go outside that house, and we'd kind of develop some of the fight sequences. And the guy who actually was the fight choreographer on that was a student of a guy called Sammy. And Sammy is one of Bruce Lee's last students.
Really?
So what he was doing was he wanted to bring Jeet Kune Do, which was Bruce Lee's main martial art, into the film. But I was coming from an Aikido background, which is kind of more hand-to-hand and throws and locks And then Don the Dragon was a kickboxer. So what we did was we mixed all of them up together. And it was at the beginning of the whole MMA and that whole grappling thing. And that scene that you're talking about, Don the Dragon wanted to get some kind of hand contact, hand breaks, wanted to get some grappling in, some ground movement. So we developed that all the night before, and then we just shot it the next day. But it was like, it's tough going. I mean, those scenes take a lot out of you when you're doing them.
Well, I'm just thinking they must take an awful lot out of you. Yet 2 seconds later, both of you are absolutely fine, and you're going off as though nothing happened.
And not a mark on us.
Not a mark on you. It's hilarious. Okay, so what we're looking at here is the IRA puts nuclear detonators in cans of Beamish. Brilliant. Yeah. Sorry. And an unsuspecting tourist is on the run for a murder he didn't commit. Nobody can be trusted. So when you read the script, Colm, yeah. I mean, like, did you read the script? Is that what you read first?
You talking to me? Colm,
first of all.
Oh, yeah. So, I literally just saw, like, that clip, which is the same one you played at the start, in that documentary about the studio in Connemara.
Yeah.
And, like, so, the first thing I heard about this was just the Beamish containing nuclear detonators.
All right, well then,
I saw very little else. Well, and I was like, I need to find it.
All right, well then, Bill, like, did you read the script in terms of, let's see what my character has to do?
Oh yeah, you always read the script. You see how long you're in this. If you're still in it at the end or towards the end, you'll take the role, you know.
Wow, that's unbelievable. Okay, so are you still doing fight scenes, by the way, or you know?
They come up every now and again in stage or film work that I'm doing, but it's not a huge part of my acting career, you know.
All right, well, a huge part of my day after the football match is definitely going to be watching the second part of that. So, Colm, just finally, like, where can people see it exactly again?
So, if you search for it on YouTube, if you search for Moving Target, it should still be up there. It's probably going to stay up there. As I said, I don't expect copyright to get in the way of it.
Right.
If you click a button to the side of it, there's usually a button for like chat replay, and you can kind of see how people reacted to it for the first time they got to see it. You can find me on like Instagram, so I got like more content about it up on social media as well.
All right. Well, Colm Callaghan, thanks a million, Colm, for talking to us. For talking to us on the program. And Bill, thank you very much indeed, and good luck with your acting career.
Thanks a million.
Moving Target is the movie. Yep. Gotta be watched. Check YouTube. Good luck. Take it easy.
All the best.
Right. Thank you.
Fanny. Weekends on 2S2S2S2S2FM. 2S2, 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 2S2,